The following is a production of Hometown and Home Country Radio Sports.
We've never seen a team like this before, ladies and gentlemen. After all this time, Bishop Garrigan is still golden. Bishop Garrigan has finally slain the Newell Fonda Dragon. Your Golden Bears are state champions for the second year in a row.
This place is packed, and it is going to be rocking in here tonight. Crooks taps it backwards, and we are underway. Buckle your seatbelts, everyone. In the lane, Crooks, center of the paint. Oh, a nice spin move, and she lays it in.
Oh, with her left hand, she claps her hands and says, let's go. You got to feed Audie this last 2 minutes.
Three-pointer is blocked at the buzzer, and that's it. After coming so close the past 2 years, Bishop Garrigan has finally won it all.
Video streaming on the Algona Radio YouTube channel is brought to you by Kemna Auto Center. It's not just about the car, it's about the care. Algona Municipal Utilities, community owned for community benefit. Bauer Plumbing and Heating of Emmitsburg and Algona. Iowa State Bank, helping people succeed. Algona Frame and Auto Body, we meet by accident. PMC Advantage Insurance, having the advantage makes all the difference. Now, here's Sports Director Tyler Lance.
One final time at home this season for the back-to-back defending state champion, Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears. As tonight, it's the Class 1A Region 6 semifinal, the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears and the St. Ansgar Saints. As tonight, Bishop Garrigan welcomes the Saint team that's been waiting all season long for this game. This is a Golden Bear team that ended St. Ansgar's season last year in the regional semis. The Saints get their crack at Bishop Garrigan once again and get a chance to get their revenge here tonight inside the Bishop Garrigan High School Gymnasium. Saints coming into the ballgame with a 14-9 record as they won handily against Newman Catholic in their first postseason game, opening for the playoffs on Tuesday night. Meanwhile, for Bishop Garrigan, they got a scare against North Iowa on Tuesday, but they ultimately survived, won that game 56-47, and moved on to tonight with a 21-2 record, getting to take on St. Ansgar for the second year in a row in this very round. It'll be the final home game of the season for Bishop Garrigan or St. Ansgar, as both teams will face a neutral site game coming up in the on Wednesday night's regional final for whichever team wins tonight's game. So this will be the final home game of the season for the Golden Bears, and they will look to advance to the regional semis once again. But it'll be a big test tonight against the St. Ansgar team that brings some good size. They've got some good shooting on their roster as well. A lot of things that will present some issues for the Golden Bears in tonight's ball game. We'll talk about it all with head coach Brandon Schwab in a couple of minutes, and we'll also talk with head coach Scott Cakerice of the St. Ansgar Saints. That'll be coming up after this message from the Iowa Girls High School Athletic Union on KLGA 92.7.
The Iowa Girls High School Athletic Union encourages positive behavior.
Pride, respect, leadership, and sportsmanship on the court and in the stands.
Remember what a great privilege it is to see your team compete.
Thank you for your attendance. Enjoy the game.
And enjoy the game.
Set for Girls Class 1A postseason basketball action right now on Hometown Radio KLGA as St. Ansgar visits Bishop Garrigan. Right now we're talking with St. Ansgar head coach Scott Cakerice. Coach, first of all, we appreciate your time today on the pregame show. Let's begin with that first playoff match you guys had against Newman Catholic earlier this week as you guys defeated the Knights 59-40. What were a couple of the big keys coming out of that game?
Well, first of all, we had played them about 10 days earlier and they had beaten us. We did not play well. We might as well have stayed home. Not taking anything away from the Newman girls because they played hard. But we played a much better ball game on Tuesday night. We attacked the basket, played good sound defense, made them handle the ball against our press, and came through with a victory.
Well, Coach, especially as of late, your team has been really good defensively. So just take me through what some of the pieces that fall into place on a good defensive night for you are.
Well, first of all, it starts with our press. We like to do different things full court-wise and make the other team handle the basketball. A lot of times high school teams, if they don't spend a lot of time on it, struggle with that area. So we want to try to take advantage of that. And that also leads to some easy baskets for us. So if we're not shooting well, we still have the ability to score some points. That's the goal. It doesn't always happen that way, but that's our goal. Second is we play pretty good half-court man-to-man defense. We don't play zone at all. For reasons I believe is to make the other team handle the ball. We can close out on the outside shooters well enough. We got a little bit of size inside, which helps control the lane somewhat. I've always been pretty much a man coach, so that's what we do, and we've always done.
Well, Coach, you head into Bishop Garrigan for tonight's matchup. Second year in a row, you'll see the Golden Bears in the playoffs. Obviously, a different-looking Golden Bear team this year. So, overall, what are a couple of things that jump out to you when scouting the Golden Bears?
Well, first of of all, you're exactly right. Brandon has a totally different team this year, and they're fun to watch play. And they've always been fun before that with Audie and everybody else. But anyway, totally different team. They're looking to shoot threes a lot, which we have to worry about defending. And not only that, but those girls can also take the ball to the basket. So it's kind of a conundrum for us, or what are we going to try to take away? And then having the freshman step up for him, Eastman on the inside this year, has really been, I'm sure, a pleasant surprise for him. And has helped fill that team out. And it's just different. You got to approach it differently. So we think we have a game plan in place. We'll find out quickly if we do or not. So we'll see.
Coach, you mentioned Eastman, the freshman for Bishop Garrigan at their center position, and you know, that creates an interesting matchup on the inside because, of course, you have Cruzy yourself, who is 6'2" on the roster. So when it comes to defending against Eastman, is that really, you know, a matchup for Cruzy, or how do you approach that as a team defending the interior against Eastman tonight?
Well, we're going to do what we have always done. We front the post as much as we can and try to get backside help. We got to vary that up with her because, again, she's a freshman, and we want to make her as uncomfortable as we can. But even doing that, for a freshman, she does a really nice job. Again, Coach Schwab has done a great job with her and has filled a huge void for them. But we got to mix things up and not let her get settled in. And that's one of the things we're going to try to do.
Coach, flipping over to the other side of the basketball, what does a good offensive night look like for you guys? And what do you expect Bishop Garrigan to throw at you defensively in tonight's game?
Well, needless to say, we have watched a lot of film on them. Actually, I've watched some stuff over them for the whole season and how they've changed things up and what they do. And I am, again, just guessing, but I'm thinking we'll see a lot of 2-3 zone from the Golden Bears. And I know they've played some man as well. They've pressed some also against certain teams, so that's something we've got to be prepared for. A good offensive night for us is when we can get out and run. And we got to control the boards to do that. And that's not easy because Eastman rebounds well and Abby Capacious is a monster on the boards. And we've got to keep those two off so that we can get out and do what we want to do. And that, again, is easier said than done.
Coach, as we wrap up along those same lines, what do you see as the biggest key for a St. Ansgar victory in tonight's game?
Well, I think we have three keys down for us. And one being not let Eastman get off on the inside. Another one would be for us is to be sure that we keep Abby off the boards. I mean, as I said earlier, she comes hard to the boards, and we got to keep her off, and then we got to control the ball, handle it, not turn it over, and give the Golden Bears easy baskets.
Well, Coach, we appreciate your time today on the pregame show and wish you best of luck in tonight's game.
Well, thank you very much.
St. Ansgar head coach Scott Kegreis with his pregame thoughts. Right now, we will step aside for a timeout and bring you more pregame coverage next, coming up on Hometown Radio KLGA.
The definition of sportsmanship is the quality of showing fairness.
Respect and generosity towards the opposing team and officials.
The things you say and do are a direct reflection of your school and community.
Please stay positive and enjoy the game.
And enjoy the game.
Enjoy the game.
Girls Class 1A postseason action coming up on Hometown Radio KLGA as right now we're getting set to talk with Bishop Garrigan head coach Brandon Schwab as the Golden Bears host St. Ansgar. Coach, first of all, thank you for joining on the pregame show today. Let's begin by recapping that opening postseason game as you guys got pushed a little bit by North Iowa, end up winning that game 56-47. So just to start our listeners off with an overview of that game and some of your thoughts coming out of that matchup against North Iowa.
Well, North Iowa has been very good defensively, and they've been a much improved team throughout the year. You know, they really defend well and with their length and make things tough on you. And we weren't able to shoot the ball well enough to kind of extend their defense out a bit, which caused them to keep it packed in. And we just weren't able to hit enough shots to really pull away. But a lot of credit to North Iowa. They've really improved throughout the year and really have been playing well lately. And it's that time of year. We're just looking to advance. And we did enough to get the job done to be able and fortunate enough to play tonight.
Well, Coach, like you said, the team survives and advances. And tonight you play against St. Ansgar in the second round of the postseason for the second year in a row. And starting off the Saints, you do have a little size on the interior. It looks like a 6'2 kind of post player. So I just want to start off there. How you kind of account for that when you have a 6'2 player on the other side playing defense in the middle?
Yeah, she's all a 6'2", that's for sure. I mean, she's going to be a handful inside defensively altering shots. I mean, she's 6'2", and long and athletic, and she's going to alter a lot of shots. And, you know, I worry about her more on the defensive end than I do the offensive end. I think we'll be able to contain her on with our defense. But, I mean, she's going to alter a lot of shots, and we're going to have to take it up strong. We're going to have to make sure that we're keeping her off of the glass, because her at 6'2" causes us some problems. But nice player inside, and we'll have our hands full with her for sure.
And, Coach, looking at St. Ansgar, it appears that they're a team that primarily wants to play man-to-man defensively. So, I guess, do you expect to see man tonight against them? And what are some keys offensively for you to attack a defense if they do, in fact, want to go man-to-man?
Yeah, you know, I expect man-to-man defense without a doubt. That's kind of been a staple of their program. You know, we played them last year, you know, with Audie and Molly, and they played us in man. It's when they were at State a few years ago, they played all man. So I think that's kind of a staple of their program, is their man-to-man defense, and I'll expect that tonight again with them. So, you know, we've just got to try to spread them out a little bit. You know, we're going to try to pull 6'2 away from the basket a little bit, put her in some ball screen situations. You know, they run a lot of switching defenses. So, you know, just try to get to our matchups that benefit our offense, you know, with the way they switch their screens and off the ball and on the ball. So they make sure their matchup is there, but it can cause some matchup problems with us if we get our offense in the right position. So, you know, it's going to be a chess match without a doubt on the adjustments he's going to make with his man throughout the game, and, you know, just different ways we're going to attack them with our man offense.
And, Coach, we've talked a lot recently about the shooting and the games where it's been hot and the games where it's cooled off. As we said, the game against North Iowa was a game where the shooting kind of cooled off. So when you look at tonight's game, how do you envision a good shooting night turning out for the team? What are some keys to that?
Well, I mean, just making a few shots. I don't know. I mean, we've taken a little different approach the last few days. I mean, we shoot a ton of in practice, and we have throughout the year. And we've dialed that back the last 2 days of practice. We haven't done a shooting drill. We haven't done any shooting drills in the last 2 days of practice. I think the kids are overthinking it a little bit. So we dialed it back a little bit. And I said, if you want shots up, get them up on your own. We came in for game plan. We came in to get ourselves crisp and sharp offensively and defensively. And we're going to go into the game. You know, I think sometimes you talk about shooting, you talk about free throw shooting, you talk about that stuff too much. And you get the kids thinking, and I think our guards are thinking right now instead of shooting. And we tried to not do shooting drills the last 2 days in practice. See, I don't think it can hurt anymore. So I'm just going to go out and try something different the last few days. And, you know, we have a great, great shooting team. We have such weapons that can shoot it from deep, and our guards need to stop thinking and just shoot it. And let's hope that we do that tonight.
Well, Coach, as we wrap up, we're going to wrap up a little bit differently today, kind of redirecting away from tonight's game, because earlier this week, the Top of Iowa West All-Conference teams were announced, and Abby Capacious was named Top of Iowa West Player of the Year. Can you just take me through, I guess, A, what that accomplishment means to Capacious, and B, what the conversations around that were like, because there was a lot of good competition for that Player of the Year spot this season?
Well, yeah, I mean, I could not be, you know, us as a team, we don't talk about individual awards much. I was able to present that award individually to Abby and her mom and dad, Joe and Brenda, and had a private moment with them. We don't try to bring any type of individual award into our practice. We don't talk about it. I think during the season, it's a team game, and Abby is a huge part of that. And you know, I'm so proud of Abby and the way she conducts herself every day in practice and on the floor, and is a true leader. You know, someone that's kind of been, you know, the third wheel on our team the last few years but having an Audie and Molly on the team, but her recognition got recognized this year. I mean, she is the best player in the conference, and she has the overall game in the conference, and I couldn't be more thrilled that she was able to receive that individual award. She has worked tremendously hard, and it shows that, you know, the best players aren't always the leading scorers. You know, she does everything little on our team that we need to be a good basketball team. And it's not just all about putting the points on the board. She's had her nights, she's had 20 plus points, but she has her nights also. She has 7 points, 16 rebounds, 7 steals, 8 assists. You know, that's the intangible part that proves how valuable Abby is to a team, and the way she can defend the other team's best player every night is something special for us. So very happy for that award for Abby, and you know, it was pretty easy consensus with our coaches in the room of who the player of the year was. So it's not just me thinking that; it was the overall majority of our conference seeing what Abby does night in and night out.
Well, Coach, we appreciate your time today on the pregame show and wish you best of luck in tonight's game.
All right, thanks, Tyler.
Bishop Garrigan Golden Bear basketball coach Brandon Schwab. We'll step aside for a timeout. More coming up next on Hometown Radio KLGA and the Algona Radio YouTube stream.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine postseason sports club members.
Dump It. They do the dirty work so you don't have to.
Greg Petting & Company, certified public accountants, where everyone counts.
Neil Albert Electric. Flip the switch to Albert Electric.
Kemco Tires, your Goodyear tire dealer.
Tom Eichen Sales, your store in the country. Highway 18, just west of Algona.
Algona Plumbing & Heating, where a good flush always beats a full house.
Postseason sports club members bringing you this game.
When it comes to new appliances, you read the reviews and analyze the reports. But many times, you just end up being more confused. That's why customers buy from North Iowa Appliance Center. They're local and they give back to the community. They carry top-performing Maytag appliances designed, engineered, and assembled right here in the United States. With over 45 years of experience, they give prompt and professional service every time. Things are coming in weekly, so stop by today and see what they have in stock. North Iowa Appliance Center, Highway 18 East in Algona, where they sell the best and service the rest. Carrying Maytag, KitchenAid, Whirlpool, and Amana.
We've got more postseason sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Grassmasters, growing satisfied customers.
Trend Salon, your complete family hair salon. It's all about you.
Lusher Family Dentistry, serving your family since 1965 on Call Street in Algona.
Iowa Lakes Community College, your community, your college.
Erpelding Excavating, they dig dirt.
Bill's Auto and Truck Repair, getting you back on the road.
All sponsors of this postseason broadcast.
A big bank can deliver the products you need and the convenience you expect. A small bank can make you feel like family. At Fidelity Bank and Trust, we don't think you should have to choose. Your hometown bankers have roots here. We understand the community and why you want to live here, because we live here too. We're big enough to deliver, yet small enough to care. Fidelity Bank and Trust, your hometown bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Your hometown Fidelity Bank and Trust, located in Bancroft, Iowa.
It's time to meet the starting lineup for the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears.
Zoe Montag, junior, number 22.
Garrigan of a steal. Here comes the transition. A sidestep by Montag in the lay-in. Zoe Montag is going crazy right now, and Garrigan's up 81-38.
Emmy Bartolo, sophomore, number 10.
Cross-court feed over to Bartolo. Catches, fires, rattles in a three-pointer.
Hey, Shawlish, sophomore, number 24.
Patius hangs and passes to the left wing. Allish three try, and she swished it again. Let Stacia Allish shoot it.
Gracelyn Eastman, freshman, number 15.
Kicks it out Eastman. Eastman a tray. Eastman knocks it down. First career three-pointer.
Abby Capacious, senior, number 21.
Capacious weaves around traffic, puts it up. She put it in the foul. Abby Capacious with a chance for a three-point play.
Tip-off of your game is coming up next on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
The Bishop Garrigan starting lineup under Coach Schwab here at the gymnasium. Bishop Garrigan boys basketball player Mari Thomas just sang the national anthem and got a rousing ovation here at the crowd. Meanwhile, for St. Ansgar and head coach Scott Cakerice, their starting lineup, the junior Amelia Porish, the senior Kinsey Anderson, senior Kaylee Hicken, senior Aspen Falk, and sophomore Lindsay Cruzy. St. Ansgar on the road, red uniforms, the white lettering on the front and back. It's the white Saints across the front and the white jersey stripe down the side. Bishop Garrigan in the home whites, the black BGHS across the front, of the black numerals on the front and black, front and back, that is, as Garrigan will have Gracelyn Eastman at midcourt. Eastman, the 5'11 freshman, will go up against the 6'2 sophomore, Lindsay Cruzy. Second year in a row, Bishop Garrigan and St. Ansgar in the regional semifinals as Cruzy makes initial contact, but Capacious collects the ball, and we are underway here from Bishop Garrigan High School. Golden Bears head left to right on the radio dial. They get it off to Allish right off the bat. Works right around the perimeter. Montag into the corner to Eastman. Now back out towards Montag. Top of the key to Allish.
Alish in between the circles, gets it left side to Bartolo. I mean, Bartolo, a second team all-conference selection that came out earlier this week, backs it up beyond the perimeter, finds Eastman. 7:38 on the clock. Eastman elbow jumper, missed it off to the right, and the rebound secured by Falk for St. Ansgar.
That's about the deepest shot I've seen Eastman take in a long, long time, Tyler. Bears look like they're going to stretch that floor, try to really pull that defense apart.
Yeah, Lindsey Cruzy, the 6'2 sophomore in the middle. Garrigan knows there's going to be some good rim protection for St. Ansgar as the Saints have the basketball right now. They average 49 points per game. Cruzy banging into Eastman. Shot up no good from the edge of the paint. Eastman secures the rebound.
Good position inside. Emi Bartolo looks to push the tempo.
Bartolo pulling up from way downtown. Rattles in the three-pointer.
Oh, those three-pointers got to come tonight here, I think, against this team with some height, and Emi gets it started.
Garrigan very cold on three-point shots against North Iowa on Tuesday night, but Bartolo pulls up from well beyond the arc for that first bucket. Here's St. Ansgar off the ball. It's Porish looking inside to Falk. Falk floats off glass, missed it. Eastman rebounds on the near side.
Cold start for St. Ansgar, but good looks at the basket.
Two huge student sections here tonight. Garrigan, of course, as usual, across from us, down towards the right side. But St. Ansgar brought a ton of students there over towards the left. Bartolo floating from the foul line, missed it right. Falk bats the rebound, but goes right to Eastman. Eastman faces the bucket. Eastman layup, good!
Oh, that's a bonus bucket. St. Ansgar had secured the rebound, somehow lost it right into the hands of Eastman. Those 2 points were just a gift there for Bishop Garrigan from St. Ansgar Saints.
Eastman averaging 16.5 points per game. There's a left-handed shot. Anderson banks off to the left, no good. Capacious fighting for the rebound and has it among two red jerseys.
She's got that leaping ability. Gives her an advantage. Even if the girls are taller, Capacious gets it.
Capacious has the ball deflect behind her back, but she gets it back up, keeps it away from Falk. It's Alish on the right wing, heads left around the perimeter. She's guarded by Hicken. Gets it out to Bartolo. Another deep tray. Another make! Emi Bartolo from downtown as she looks to the student section and gives Garrigan an 8-point advantage.
She is feeling it, and she was 4 feet behind the 3-point line in pretty much both her shots.
Emi Bartolo is about a 35% 3-point shooter. That is number 3 in the top of Iowa West. The ball is inside, but it's blocked. Cruzy got rejected that time as Eastman stayed vertical, and now here come the Bears. Close the other way. It's Alish weaving, stopping on the wing with 5:39 on the clock. Eastman top of the key. Eastman stops, flings it left to Bartolo. Will pass with the free. She'll get to the foul line instead. She'll find Eastman. Eastman driving in. Got to the rack and scored it. 10 straight points to start the game by Garrigan. And a timeout called. The 3-point shooting there tonight. The interior scoring of Rachel Eastman and Beanie. Garrigan couldn't have started this game any better after Tuesday night.
Oh, couldn't have been any better. Emi Bartolo hitting those 2 threes. 6 points. Boy, that's like a huge shot to the gut if you're St. Ansgar right off the bat. She was well beyond the arc. They didn't think she'd shoot it from back there. She makes them pay. And there's the other 4 points by Eastman inside. Oh boy, what a start for the Bears. Just a nightmare start for the Saints here from St. Ansgar, Tyler. What are they telling them in the huddle? It's hard. Now you can't restart. You're down 10-0. You're already playing from behind.
You're telling your team, take a deep breath, because St. Ansgar, they've gotten some good looks inside in their first couple of possessions, but they've missed some point-blank shots so far. They've left some points on their side of the court, so if you just start taking a deep breath, making a couple more of those layups, you've got to work your way back into it. But I think you're also banking on Bartolo not making shots from 6 feet beyond the three-point line all night as well. So Saints know this is a good start by Garrigan. Anderson into the front court. The senior gets it into the left corner to Falk. Falk works against Capacious, gets it out to Hicken. Back to the right side, she'll find Porish. Out to Hicken on the wing, guarded by Bartolo. 5:10 on the clock, in the high post towards Falk. Flings the left side, Anderson. Works the baseline. Anderson floats with a wild shot, but draws the foul as she goes crashing towards the padding along the baseline. Abby Capacious picking up her first of the night.
Garrigan is pressing full court, and they're falling back into a very aggressive defense, forcing the St. Ansgar Saints to drive. They are not able to get in their offense there, and the guard does a nice job driving, picking up a foul on Capacious, who got in some foul trouble the other day, and she was frustrated with that first call. I know she doesn't want to get foul trouble again today.
Anderson misses the first free throw off the back of the cup. Anderson this year 45.7% from the foul line. Foul shooting a weakness for the Saints. They're just over 52% from the line this season, as they'll have to increase that number tonight. 5:05 left, quarter number one. Free throw Anderson bounces into the cup. Friendly rubber rim, and St. Ansgar has their first score of the evening. 10-1 Bishop Garrigan. Bartolo of pace finds the trailing Capacious left side. Abby Capacious just selected as top of Iowa West player of the year. Bartolo, not a deep tray. Oh, she hit it again! Keep shooting it, Abby Bartolo!
Each shot is deeper than the one before it. She was way back on that one.
She's feeling it. That was Curry-esque range, or should I say Caitlin Clark-esque range for Emi Bartolo.
How much has Caitlin Clark made young girls take these super deep threes? As long as they're making them.
She's a role model for sure, as Falk has it on left elbow. Falk, guarded by Capacious, gets it back outside towards Porish. Porish, top of the key, she'll drive right side. Turn back by Montag. Turn around Jay. Left it short. Rebound by Cruzy. Put back wildly at the top of the glass. And Eastman rebounds for Garrigan. Here comes Bartolo the other way. Bartolo on left wing, guarded closely by Anderson. Bartolo Gives it off to Eastman, left wing. 4:17 left in the first quarter. Now it's Allish near side of the court. Back to Montag, left side. Allish screens. Montag heads right. Flips it towards Capacious. Capacious shovels to Eastman. Eastman layup up and in.
Just absolutely picking apart the defense. St. Ansgar just cannot stay with that Garrigan offensive movement. Open shot for Eastman. Wide open under the hoop.
15-1 Bishop Garrigan. And this is the genius of Coach Schwab in this offense in action right now. It's Hicken left side for St. Ansgar. Golden Bears a stingy defense this year, allowing just 39.5 points per game. They're already up 15-1 over the Saints here in quarter number one. Here's a sidestep, free by Porsche, missed it left. Long rebound out to Capacious near side. Abby Capacious averaging a double-double, but throws it away. Falk intercepts it. Falk up to Anderson. Anderson left in the paint, shoots over Capacious and spun it in.
Well, now we get a first glimpse of how St. Ansgar has got their way here. They can convert in transition.
Zoe Montag, right side corner. Montag slicing towards the lane, shoots over the top of Cruising and draws the foul. Zoe Montag going to be shooting two for Bishop Garrigan. And the foul was not against Cruising, but it was against Porish, as that'll be her first personal and the first team foul on St. Ansgar.
Well, this Garrigan crowd has showed up for the very final game in this gym, whether it's boys or girls. This is the last basketball game this year in the Garrigan gym, and the crowd is here, and they're loving it.
Montag free throw off the back of the cup, no good. Yeah, congratulations to the Garrigan boys. Last night defeated Norfolk Kensett 65-57. They'll play Lake Mills for the third time this season on Tuesday night. Lake Mills with just one loss this season, that being to North Union back in December. So we'll see if Garrigan can add number two coming up Tuesday night as Montag rims out on the free throw. The box out on the rebound by Aspen Falk. Falk, a second-team all-conference top of Iowa East selection, averaging 5.3 rebounds per game for the Saints this year. Here's Falk left side. She'll give it off towards Porish. Porish looking into the cutting Falk. Falk got to the rack and scored it.
Well, nice cut by Falk. Just got the defender right on her hip and busted to the basket quickly.
Pass up ahead to Montag. Looks for Eastman. Eastman in the paint. Eastman against Cruzy. Eastman off glass for two.
Garrigan offense is looking quick. Very good attacks to the basket.
9 points by Bartolo, 8 by Eastman. That's the Garrigan scoring so far as they lead 17-5. Here's Anderson working the dribble. Anderson finding Porsche onto the elbow. It's Cruzy. Cruzy against Eastman. Turns around, stops for a jumper. That ball got tipped, and Capacious has the rebound as it missed everything.
Cruzy getting frustrated. Eastman is doing some good challenging there defensively and always has a hand in her face.
Yeah, Cruzy really appears to like that turnaround mid-range shot. She tried that a couple times so far tonight, but Eastman ready for it. Here's Allish slicing in, cut up by Cruzy, finds the cutting Capacious, got inside and scored it again.
Well, and there you see why Capacious is the player of the year in our conference. She really knows where to be all the time.
And she is a master of off-ball movement. I say it all the time, but everyone watch what Abby Capacious does when she doesn't have the basketball as Eastman bumps Cruzy and fouls. That is number two against Bishop Garrigan and the first on Eastman.
Yeah, Eastman was waiting to see if there would be a travel call, but they get called for the foul. I think that was kind of a build-up foul. Eastman is getting a little more aggressive each time down the floor, and the official was making sure they called her there so she doesn't get too rough.
Hicken inbound center of the paint to Porish. Porish misses off glass to the right. Balls along the baseline, picked up by St. Ansgar on the offensive board. Ball gets stripped away from Hicken, though, and the Golden Bears steal it. Here comes Bartolo up the near side. Bartolo into the lane. Bartolo driving all the way in. Wild layup, no good. Rebound by Cruzy. Here's Anderson sprinting up the floor. Anderson across the foul line. Nice bounce pass to Falk, and Falk finishes. What an assist by Anderson.
Boy, great transition basketball by St. Ansgar. They know how to run the floor really well, but they have not been able to convert in their half-court offense.
Well, St. Ansgar has settled into this game, but the problem is they spotted Garrigan 10 points. It's 19-7 Garrigan. Allish arcs up a three, rattles off, no good. Ball deflected towards the baseline. Last touch by the Saints. Garrigan will keep it as Gary the Bear collects that loose basketball.
Oh, Gary the Bear, man in the door over there with Father Zach. And right in front of the Garrigan student section. I think Gary the Bear keeps that student section in line, make sure they don't get all out of control. They're all dressed up like construction workers over there. Caution section all over the place.
Yeah, it's a hard hat and a lunch pail kind of evening here at Bishop Garrigan High School, but Gary the Bear, he's the enforcer. He's the rim protector down there.
Thanks, Gary.
Gets to hang out with the cheerleaders the whole game, too, as Reagan Murphy catches in the high post off the inbounds pass. Murphy just checked in for Eastman for Bishop Garrigan. Now it's Bartolo, heads right across the foul line. Bartolo shovels to Capacious, center of the paint, shoots over Cruzy, and it rims out, no good. Everett butt down on the rebound controlled by Kaylee Hicken, who just checked in.
Great dish by Bartolo. She's really having a game.
Kaylee Hicken, who stays in, I should say, as St. Ansgar has made their first sub. Kenzie Peterson in, wearing jersey number 5. Porish. Gets it into the lane to Cruzy. Looks underneath towards Falk. Tipped out of bounds by Allish. They wanted the high-low look that time, but Allish was able to get in front of Falk.
Garrigan playing their 2-3 defense. Murphy in the middle. Capacious and Allish on her side.
19-7, Garrigan. Cruzy catches in the lane, bangs it off the window, pops out of the cup, no good. Rebound deflection is picked up by Peterson for the offensive rebound. St. Ansgar has it with 59 seconds left in the first. Saints are about a 36% shooting team this season. On field goals is it's Hicken working the right side. She'll shovel off towards Porsche, looking into Cruzy. Cruzy got good position, and she lays it up and in.
Well, that's the first team Garrigan's seen in a while that can throw a nice lob pass into their post. That was a good play, good execution by St. Ansgar. Eastman still on the bench with a foul. Coach Schwab doesn't want to get her in foul trouble.
Capacious collects the ball by Bartolo. Garrigan started up 10-0. Since that time, both teams have scored 9 points. Saints have settled in, but did they spot Garrigan too much? That's going to be the question throughout the night. Bartolo left wing three. That one is short. Ball deflects off of Allish's hands, and it's collected by St. Ansgar's Peterson. Peterson outlet pass up towards Porish. Porish into the cutting Cruzy. Cruzy left side layup. Pops out, no good. Offensive ball to Cruzy. Knocked away by Murphy. Cruzy got it back. Throws towards the lane. Pass taken away by Alyssa Hoagland. 8 seconds left in the first quarter. Here's Bartolo. Bartolo of five. Out to Allish. Allish wants to drive with three. Allish with two. Backs up. Step back three. Allish. And she cans it! At the very end of the quarter, Sasha Allish knocks down a three. 22-9, Bishop Garrigan. And the three balls are back, ladies and gents. We head to the second quarter on KLGA 92.7. It's Bishop Garrigan 22, St. Ansgar 9.
Thank you to these postseason sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Algona Frame and Auto Body. We meet by accident.
Purpling Boyd & Company, CPAs. They're not just about taxes.
Algona Livestock Auction. Sales every Monday.
American Glass. For all your glass needs, think American.
Countryside Barbecue Sauce with two sauces for all seasons.
Farm and Home Services. Check their listings at farmhomeservices.com.
Postseason Sports Club members bringing you this game.
Is your student athlete on the injured list? This is Shane Meschke, one of the physical therapists at Kossuth Regional Health Center. Our medical team is ready to help get your athlete back in the game. KRHC offers concussion testing, therapy and rehab services, family medicine, 24-hour emergency care, x-ray services, and more. Our staff works closely with local health care providers and specialists throughout the area for a recovery plan that works for you. Best of luck to all our area athletes this season. We'll be cheering for you. Players, put your pinky rings up
to the moon. Yes. A barrage of three-point balls in quarter number one by Bishop Garrigan. They hit four three-pointers and lead 22-9 over St. Ansgar. Saints have the ball with the basket towards the left. With the ball right now at St. Ansgar, Hicken on the wing, looking into the paint, thrown away, and Montag intercepts. Garrigan will bring it across half court. St. Ansgar does turn it over 18 times a game this season. Garrigan turning it over just 13 times a game. Allish on the left wing hit that three-pointer at the very end of the first quarter. As Allish crosses over, Allish slicing in, Allish takes contact, and a foul against St. Ansgar, their first of the quarter.
Allish goes kind of one-on-four there. St. Ansgar did a nice job closing her off, kept her from getting to the hoop. Fortunate to get the foul call there. Garrigan's going to line up with four across, four low. Bartolo going to inbound the ball. Eastman back in the game looking for this inbounds play.
Bartolo gets into Capacious at the elbow, looks into Eastman, center of the paint. Eastman working the dribble right side. Eastman blew by everyone, missed the layup though. Got her on his back and kicks it out towards Allish. Josie jars into the ball game for St. Ansgar as a free ball misses for Garrigan. Long rebound out to St. Ansgar and a foul by Bishop Garrigan. That was Anderson out hustling everyone to the board, and Garrigan picks up their first foul of the quarter.
Yeah, we'll see how St. Ansgar responds. That three-pointer at the end of the first quarter was just a dagger by Sasha Allish, a step back three. And that 22-9 deficit is looming large. Thank goodness the three-point ball has returned.
Yeah, Bishop Garrigan, as we said, down the stretch in the regular season just did not shoot the three ball well, but tonight they have come out hitting just about everything. Some way downtown frees by Bartolo. Here's a free by Porish, no good. She left it short. Anderson sailing in for the rebound, but came in out of control and lost it. Eastman outlets to Bartolo. Bartolo, a nice sidestep, got to the bucket. Layup spins out. Everywhere but down on the ball's out of bounds. Last touch by Bishop Garrigan.
Boy, this is the kind of game every call is scrutinized by both sides of the gym. Every call, that a 50-50 ball, each side of the gym thinks it's theirs.
Here's St. Ansgar off the basketball. It's Peterson. Gets it out between the circles to Falk. Now back to the right side to Peterson. Into the right corner to Jar. Jar wants the baseline. Eastman cuts her off. Pass goes back out towards Anderson. Anderson in the lane. Left-handed floater. Bounces on the rim and drops through.
Nice drive there by Anderson. They're going to throw on the press, try to slow Bishop Garrigan down.
Anderson is a first-team all-conference selection in the top of Iowa East. Here's the pass to Eastman, right side block. Eastman powers it up. Ball spins out. Eastman put back. That one's no good. It got tipped. Eastman trying to keep it alive, but she can't. And here comes Falk. Falk sprinting the floor. Falk inside. Got to the bucket. Layup spins out. Montag rebound and a foul by St. Ansgar as Anderson reached into the cookie jar.
Well, Garrigan just dominating the rebounding now. It seems like when Eastman puts up her shot offensively, she always gets her own rebound. And defensively, Montag hustling the floor there, getting the rebound, not giving St. Ansgar a second chance looks.
Hicken back in as Peterson heads to the bench for St. Ansgar. Saints will set up in the full court press here against Garrigan. Pass jump by Falk, she intercepts it. Falk has a wide open bucket, and she missed the layup. Capacious rebounds. That's going to be a miss that Falk regrets. Outlet towards Allish. Finds Eastman all by herself. Eastman got hacked. She put it in and the foul. Jar came back on defense trying to foul Eastman to prevent the bucket, but that foul was too late, and it's a chance for a three-point play.
What a sequence. They missed the wide open layup. We go back down. Bishop Garrigan gets a three-point play possibility by Eastman. Everything going right for the Bears tonight, Tyler.
Absolutely. This offense is clicking on all cylinders. I'll tell you what, Coach Schwamp doesn't see a whole lot of teams playing against Garrigan in man-to-man defense, but he's got a lot of good plans for when that does happen, and he is opening up the playbook tonight for that. Plus the transition for Garrigan good as well. Here's a 15-foot jumper missing by Falk. Ooh, contact along the baseline. That's going to be a foul against St. Ansgar. That is their fourth of the quarter.
Yeah, it's a quick two fouls on number 33 there. You know, I will say, all offenses are a heck of a lot easier when you've got girls shooting 25-foot three-point shots and making it.
Yeah, that certainly helps as well for Bishop Garrigan, and this is the kind of stretch of game that shows how dangerous Bishop Garrigan can be throughout the course of the season when they're hot shooting.
And this is what we were used to the majority of the season, Garrigan shooting three-pointers, getting out to a big lead, forcing the other team to scramble and try to come back in the game. And boy, this is great to see tonight that Bishop Garrigan on track here.
Natalie Bork, the 5'11 senior, checks in for St. Ansgar as Jar will head to the bench with those two personal fouls. 5:54 left in the second quarter, 24-11 Bishop Garrigan, as Capacious has it top of the key, looks into Eastman. Eastman working her way against Cruzy. Fades back for a jumper and hits it.
Good move by Eastman. Sticks her pivot foot, swings left, and knocks it in.
Here's Bork looking outside for Anderson. Anderson trying to track it down on the left corner, working against Bartolo, powering her way in. Anderson works along the baseline and brings it out to the far corner. She went right into Bartolo that time as Allish tries to strip the ball away from Anderson and gets called for a foul. Anderson checks in at 5'4", but she is physically lowering the shoulder there when she's trying to drive to the bucket.
Boy, you can see a lot of fight in that young woman's face.
Sasha Allish picks up her first foul, and Anderson will go to the line. Anderson averaging 9.3 points per game this season. A 45% foul shooter, though. And she'll set up for two. Anderson, first one, will miss off to the right. Still 26-11, Bishop Garrigan.
Yeah, and she looks out of sync on her shots at the free throw line, which usually is a good sign of how they're shooting in the open field. And that's been the disaster for St. Ansgar so far. They have missed a lot of good shots at the basket.
Second free throw, that one pops out. Cruzy controls the rebound, but now Montag's trying to rip it away, but Cruzy kicks it out. Anderson, right side wing, rattles it in. If the free throws don't go down, just hit a three.
I guess in the modern game, you just got to shoot deeper.
8 points so far by Anderson, 26-14, Bishop Garrigan. Allish in the right side corner for the Golden Bears. Allish gets it up top towards Bartolo. Guarded by Anderson. Bartolo gives to Eastman along the perimeter. Eastman driving in. Eastman taking long strides. Eastman wide angle. No good on the layup. Rebound controlled by Cruzy. Here comes Anderson. Anderson sees an opening. Anderson takes it all the way in. Way too strong of a layup. Cruzy rebound. Put back no. And Montag has the rebound for Garrigan.
There's another time. St. Ansgar, two point blank looks at the basket. Missed them both.
That's a developing theme early in this game. A lot of point-blank looks for St. Ansgar just have not gone so far tonight. Boy, Garrigan just didn't pick up the ball when Anderson was driving in. As Montag drives the other way, left-handed layup, no. And now Garrigan misses a point-blank look.
Good drive to the basket, though, by Montag with her left. Just didn't get it to go.
Inside to Cruzy on the right side block. Faces Eastman, puts it off glass, no. Eastman rebound on the right side.
Well, Eastman did a nice job of getting position, going straight up, raising the degree of difficulty on that shot without fouling.
A lot of energy here, quick pace, as Bartolo gets it out to Montag. Montag, three-pointer, misses right. Rebound taken by Allish as he sails in. Looks out to Bartolo. Left side corner, arcs up the free, swished it again!
Well, Bartolo can't get any hotter. Has she missed one? She has missed one, I think. 4-for-5 from the three-point line, Emmy Bartolo.
She's missed 2, 4-for-6 tonight, but 12 points lead the way. 29-14, Bishop Garrigan as St. Ansgar calls a full timeout. We'll take it as well on 92.7 KLGA as Bishop Garrigan leads 29-14.
High school sports on Home Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine postseason sports club members.
Style Salon, your salon in Algona. Create yourself.
Holmes Animal Clinic, caring for your pets, big and small. They love them all.
Daylight Donuts, open early, serving freshly made donuts, rolls, and coffee.
Take Wellness Center, Algona, and Armstrong, keeping athletes in the game.
Billy Offerman, your State Farm insurance agent.
The Water Connection, from softeners to bottled water and service. Call 295-SOFT.
All sponsors of this postseason game broadcast.
At Wiffles Hybrids, they're completely focused on developing and producing the very best seed corn on the planet. It's an act they've been polishing for more than 70 years, right here in the heart of the Corn Belt. Wiffles Hybrid, one thing done right. For more information, contact Rich Rosenmeyer, Dale Lappy, or Mitchell Carroll at JDR Seed of Wesley, 515-341-2452, or visit wiffles.com.
Bishop Garrigan 29, St. Ansgar 14 as the free balls continue to rain down. Beanie, if you're St. Ansgar, is there a solution to all these threes that Garrigan's hitting?
Boy, they have to go out and cover that three-point line, and they have been doing so, but as soon as they do, Garrigan goes inside to Eastman and Capacious.
St. Ansgar has the basketball right now. The bucket is towards our left as Anderson has it right wing. Gets the screen from Cruzy, bounce pass out to Falk. Falk guarded by Capacious. Falk driving left side, lost the ball, tries to slide and collect it as she's able to save the possession. Now heading right around the perimeter for St. Ansgar's Hicken. Into the high post to Cruzy. Cruzy looks, passing left side to Falk. Falk looks for the baseline, Capacious cuts her off. Not on the shot clock. Allish knocks the ball away, but Allish fouls. Allish ran into Hicken that time and picks up her second foul of the quarter.
Boy, this is the most aggressive defense I've seen Allish play in quite a while. To be honest, I think she's probably gotten away with a couple of fouls. And that's Garrigan can do that on defense. You know, that's Newell Fonda's MO, and we saw that earlier in the season. You can get away with a lot of contact, put that pressure on the officials to call those fouls.
That's a great point. As Allish takes a seat on the bench right now, and Alyssa Hoagland checks in for the Golden Bears. It's Anderson for St. Ansgar, gets it out to Falk, near half court. 3:30 left in the first half. Now to the right wing to Hicken. Hicken looking inside to Cruzy, intercepted by Eastman. Just reached that arm right out and plucked the ball out of the sky. As now there's 3:24 left in the first half. Montag on the right wing for Garrigan. The junior takes one dribble and finds Bartolo. Heads right and shovels back to Montag. Montag slicing into the lane. Montag left-hander, spits out of the cup, no good. Still 29-14, here comes Anderson. Anderson flings left side, looking for Porsche. Now inside to Cruzy, ripped away by Capacious on the physical defense. Here's Abby Capacious into the front court. Capacious stomps and brings it back out, finding Eastman. Eastman to Trey, and that one goes down! Even Graceland Eastman is hitting the threes tonight, Beanie.
I stand corrected. That was the longest shot I've seen Eastman take in a long, long time.
Graceland Eastman, third three-point make of the season. She came into tonight 2 of 5 on triples. 2:42 left in the first half. Here's a Falk three, and Falk rims out no good. That one almost went down. Rebound by Cruzy and the foul. Well, Cruzy definitely causing some issues inside for Garrigan tonight, but Eastman and her are just battling down for those rebounds.
And that's another example of Garrigan has really amped up their defensive pressure. We did not see this kind of effort against North Iowa defensively. Garrigan really going after it, taking risks, getting called for fouls every now and then, but there's not one ball that's not contested in the lane. Cruzy hits that first free throw.
Cruzy, 45% from the foul line this season, knocks down the free throw and makes it 32-15. These teams also matched up in the regional semifinal last year as Bishop Garrigan won that game 71-50. Audie Crooks had 44 in that one, and Molly Joyce had 18, combining for 62 of Garrigan's 71. And the second free throw goes down as well. But that's a game, Beanie, where you probably can't learn a whole lot from that. Both these teams just have such dramatically different rosters from that year, and this game has taken a whole different feel in itself. Capacious on the right side, works her way in, finding Eastman on the right block. Eastman, off glass, scores! And a timeout called by Coach Schwab. 34-16, Bishop Garrigan, 2:25 up in the first half on Hometown Radio, KLGA.
Thank you to these postseason sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Helmer's Insurance Agency, stop by for an insurance quote today.
Central Financial Group, where you belong.
Your local Red Power team in Bancroft, Corwith, West Bend, and Humboldt.
Shoemaker Well and Water Care, they know water from the bottom of the tap.
Al Lobig Marine and Wesley, Hampton Boats and Mercury Outboards.
Lent's Funeral Home, someone who cares and understands.
All sponsors of this postseason game broadcast.
Is your student athlete on the injured list? We can help.
This is Wendy Wagner, physical therapy assistant at Kossuth Regional Health Center. As a former student athlete and coach, I want to help you get back in the game feeling healthy and injury-free. Our staff works closely with local healthcare providers and specialists throughout the area for a recovery plan that works for you. Best of luck to all our area athletes this season. We will be cheering for you.
Kossuth Regional Health Center, your home for healthcare.
Bishop Garrigan 34, St. Ansgar 16, as the Saints have the basketball coming out of the Bishop Garrigan timeout. 2:25 left in the first half as Anderson brings it across the timeline, heading towards the left. Now it's Falk on the right wing, guarded by Alyssa Hoagland right now for Garrigan. Goes back around the left towards Peterson, now onto the wing towards Anderson. Into the cutting, Falk in the paint. Falk goes back out towards Peterson. Quick move, ball move from St. Ansgar. It's Falk on the left side, looking down to the baseline to Porsche. Back out to Falk. 15 on the shot clock. Wings it across to Anderson. Cut off by Capacious. Flings it to Falk. Falk, catch and shoot jumper. Little bit too strong. Got her own miss back and gets it back outside towards Porsche. Porsche, lob towards Anderson. Intercepted by Capacious. Here's Abby Capacious running the floor. Capacious got to the rack and scores.
Great steal and bucket by Capacious and hustle back on defense. St. Ansgar just is not reacting fast enough. Their defense can't react fast enough for the Bears' offense. And their offense is behind the Bear defense somehow.
20-point lead right now by Bishop Garrigan. Falk into the left corner to Porish. Porish, leading scorer for the Saints at 10 points per game. As now it's Peterson right side. Peterson flings it over to Falk. 16 on the shot clock. Falk pass almost intercepted by Hoagland. Now Bartolo races in. She pokes it away from Anderson. Bartolo runs the floor. Bartolo layup. No! Falk tracks down the rebound for St. Ansgar. Gets it out to Peterson. 1:17 left in the first half. Peterson, bounce pass into the right corner. Catch and shoot three, Porish. Porish left a little short, and Eastman vacuums in another rebound. Here's Bartolo, weaving past Porish. Bartolo pulls up from way downtown. Missed it off to the right. Sailing in for the rebound is Porish. Porish weaving to the front court with 1 minute left in the first half. Angles towards the right side. Porish looks into the paint. It's Cruzy backing away in against Eastman. Cruzy off glass. Ball will settle into the cup.
There's a big sigh of relief by the St. Ansgar crowd that's right in front of our booth here, Tyler. They have been waiting for just a normal basket to fall for St. Ansgar, and Cruzy gets one there.
36-18 Bishop Garrigan. 40 seconds left in the first half as there's a 15-second difference between game clock and shot clock right now as Bartolo will dribble away some of that time near half court. Anderson slowly starting to creep out towards Bartolo, and now the 5-second count starts. Bartolo's got to either get rid of the ball or move towards the bucket. Gets it off to Capacious. Capacious drives in. Capacious bangs away into Cruzy and missed on the shot. Ball is pinballed out of bounds. Last touch by Zoe Montag. Cruzy just put up a brick wall in front of Capacious that time, and Capacious Beanie is a tough customer. It is not hard, or it is hard to stonewall Capacious when she drives in like that, as Cruzy just did.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to try to take a charge from Capacious. She can hit pretty hard, and I speak from experience there. Boy, the St. Ansgar defense has just got to pick up their pace. They look a step slow. Garrigan is just having their way with them. Capacious is such a good facilitator. You get her the ball on the wing or in the middle of the lane, and she will find the open person. But that time, she tries to do it all herself.
As Garrigan offense is just so dynamic and so active, even when they don't have the ball in their hands, as we have 13 seconds left in the first half. Saints can take the last shot if they wanted. It's Anderson. Anderson to the elbow. Anderson 15-footer, left it short, and Eastman grabs the rebound. 5 seconds left, finds her guard Bartolo. Bartolo up ahead towards Reese Kemna. Kemna lets it fly. Kemna missed on the three. Had a good look there, but it just rimmed out at the end of the second quarter. A great first half, though, for Bishop Garrigan. Golden Bears lead 36-18 in this Class 1A Region 6 semifinal as we head to halftime on 92.7 KLGA and at the Elkhorn Radio YouTube live stream.
We've got more postseason sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
The Market. Be happy. Shop The Market.
Nielsen Trucking. Your project is their priority.
Innovation Salon and Spa for your Aveda and massage needs.
Wine and Spirits, locally owned at 111 South Phillips Street.
J&J Custom Meats, located in Whittemore.
Roffler Electric. Don't be left in the dark. Call 295-7117 today.
Bringing you this postseason game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Financial investments are very important, but so are the investments of time, patience, and encouragement our young athletes receive from their coaches, teachers, and mentors. That's why Edward Jones is a proud sponsor of high school sports coverage on Hometown and Home Country Radio. Contact Bruce Keith, Jerry Sokup, Mackenzie Jorgensen, or Brady Ross, your local Edward Jones financial advisors, for all your investment needs. Edward Jones, member SIPC. Thank you to these postseason sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Mansky Farm Drainage, providing top quality professional services to the area since 1969.
Tangle Salon for all your cuts, colors, and massage therapy needs.
Fairway Meat and Grocery, everything's easier, fresher, and faster with Algona Fairway.
Algona Municipal Utilities, community owned for community benefit.
Farmer State Bank, serving Whittemore, West Bend, and Algona.
Algona Chamber of Commerce, putting the go in Algona.
All sponsors of this broadcast.
Signworks Inc. has solutions for your signage needs, as well as vehicle graphics in all sizes, from a logo on the window to wrapping your entire vehicle, whether it's a banner, magnetic, or building signage. Signworks Inc. strives to provide fast, friendly service. They also are a source for custom screen printing on garments. If they can't provide you with what you need, they will direct you to who can. They are your local resource for signage and screen printing, using your ideas and their creativity. Signworks Inc., 1613 East Locust Street, Algona, 295-9500 44, or email info at signworksinc.com.
It's Bishop Garrigan 36, St. Ansgar 18 at the half, and the Class 1A Region 6 semifinal round, as the winner tonight will play the winner of Riceville or Gladbrook-Rhinebeck on Wednesday at a neutral site. Looking at the scoring in the first half, Bishop Garrigan jumped out to a quick 10-0 lead right off the jump, and they led 22-9 at the end of the first quarter. Bishop Garrigan would have a 14-9 scoring advantage in the second, settling into this 36-18 lead at the half. Individual scoring went like this for Bishop Garrigan: Grayson Eastman, 17 first half points. Emmy Bartolo had 12. It was Abby Capacia scoring 4, and Sasha Alisha 3. On the St. Ansgar side of things, Kinsey Anderson has 8 points right now, Lindsay Cruzy has 6, and Aspen Falk has 4. I'm Tyler Lance, my partner's Beanie Bodie. Beanie, I'll start here. I think one thing for St. Ansgar, you mentioned earlier in the first half, speeding up a little bit on defense, just a step slow on defense. I'd take it one step further and say they need to speed up a little bit on defense, maybe slow down a touch on offense as well, as they've gotten out of control a couple of times. I just think there's a lot of pressure in a game like this. You're going against a Garrigan team you know can really lay on the points, so they're kind of feeling that pressure on both ends of the court.
Yeah, we certainly haven't watched as much film as Coach Schwab has before this game, but you can see that St. Ansgar has been able to score a lot of transition buckets by their guards. Anderson's a very good guard. They've been able to steal the ball and get it up the court against the Bears, but they haven't seen a team as athletic as Bishop Garrigan. The Bishop Garrigan guards, Bartolo, Alish, Montag, Capacious, and company, I mean, they've got 4 super athletic guards, and those guards are getting back anytime St. Ansgar gets an advantage and making it hard for them to get to the hoop, so they're just not getting the baskets that have come easily for them all season, I'm sure. And that has really flustered them. To make things even more frustrating, the only way you can win games is score points, and St. Ansgar has missed so many easy shots, and that is just such a demoralizing thing when you're playing a basketball game and you miss the easy shots. If you're having to take 3-pointers and they don't win, you kind of just shrug your shoulders and say, well, that'll happen. But when you're missing those easy shots, it is really hard to stay positive. And you can see the St. Ansgar coaches imploring his team during the timeouts that they can fix this, but they're going to have to fix it fast because they've been doubled up on at halftime, and rarely can a team come back from that kind of deficit. I'm not saying it couldn't be done, but so far this has shaken out as the bracket makers have made it. The top seed usually rolls through in girls basketball until the sub-state game, and Garrigan is in the driver's seat right now.
Bishop Garrigan is in the driver's seat right now, and like you said, Beanie, St. Ansgar has missed a lot of point-blank shots near the bucket, and it's not for lack of offensive rebounding and putback attempts. In fact, I don't have the rebounding numbers in front of me. Sorry, folks, I'm running the scoreboard here on the YouTube stream, so it's too much to keep track of at once, but I'd venture to say St. Ansgar has gotten more offensive rebounds than Bishop Garrigan has tonight. They've got good size inside. They've got athletic guards that are pursuing the basketball pretty well, but the putbacks just haven't been there. You know, they've kicked it out a couple of times for 3. That hasn't fallen. Just a lot of things on offense that probably work well on a normal night for St. Ansgar just aren't working well tonight.
Yeah, Gracelyn Eastman really showed up ready to play. I know Cruzy has been scoring a lot of inside points for St. Ansgar. She's got the height to shoot over the top of most people in the conference, but now she's got basically a doppelganger she's playing against. Her and Gracelyn Eastman are about the same height. But Gracelyn Eastman has done a fantastic job getting in position inside. And, boy, she's brought her offensive game, too. Had a couple nice moves to the hoop and shooting a 3-point shot, her third of the year, and draining it. How about the 3-point shooting for Garrigan, Tyler? Emmy Bartolo starts off the game. Couple 3-pointers right in a row. Eastman hits one. Alish hits a huge one at the end of the first quarter. If those don't go and you take off those 16 points, it's only 20 to 18 right now. And, you know, it's, of course, obviously a much different game, and that's the way games go. But Garrigan has not been shooting the three-pointers that well as of late. So to see those girls start ripping them in, boy, that's just a huge monkey off the back of all these girls. And Emmy Bartolo, boy, she showed up confident. You know, she is just like all the others. She hasn't been shooting her percentage lately, but, boy, she clearly had forgotten about that. And that's what you have to do as a shooter. You forget about all your misses, and you keep shooting them. And great shot there.
Yeah, the three-point shooting has been electric so far tonight for Bishop Garrigan. And also, Abby Capacious, once again, just a floor general for Garrigan, moving out the basketball. And some of the passes Capacious has made tonight against the man-to-man defense has been absolutely tremendous. Her court vision is unbelievable. And, you know, she was just honored being the top of Iowa Player of the Year. And that really just goes to show, as Coach Schwamm talked about in the pregame, that you don't have to lead the conference in scoring to be Player of the Year. Capacious just does everything right across the board. There's really not a true weakness in her game. And the coaches in the conference recognize that, and we're seeing it on display here tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. Totally agree with you, Tyler. Boy, it's when you looked at warm-ups tonight, you thought this is going to be a contest. Like, both teams look very athletic, and it's true, but St. Ansgar just seems to be a step slower than the Bishop Garrigan team tonight. And I think it's just maybe this is one of the things that when you play on the road, sometimes you start slow. So I anticipate St. Ansgar to have a little more quickness in their step, but you drive all the way over from St. Ansgar, you get in this gym, and boy, the Bears just came out at a much different tempo than the Saints.
Well, Bishop Garrigan leads 36-18 at the half, as we'll step aside for another timeout. The second half of basketball action is coming up in about 2.5 minutes on 92.7 KLGA and at the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine postseason sports club members.
Northwest Bank, commitment you can bank on.
Miller Construction of Algona, proud supporters of high school athletics.
Anytime Fitness of Algona, your local gym and fitness destination.
Bauer Plumbing and Heating, your local Amana dealer, serving Emmitsburg and Algona.
Prism Wealth Advisors, your roadmap to financial freedom.
Electronic Specialties, North Iowa's communication professionals.
Postseason sports club members, bringing you this game.
At Kemna Auto Center, they understand that you have no shortage of options when it comes to purchasing or servicing your car. They're your hometown dealer for new GM, Ford, and Chrysler makes and models. Plus, they also offer an extensive selection of pre-owned vehicles. Serving you with a dedicated sales and finance team, along with world-class service technicians that are passionate about keeping your ride in top shape. Visit their showrooms today for an experience you deserve. Kemna Auto Center in Algona.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio, brought to you by these fine postseason sports club members.
Steyer Flooring, home of the Fluorinator.
Algona Feed Store, with all your feed needs.
River Road Golf Club, your friends are here.
Murphy Realty and Management, serving Algona and the surrounding area.
Nutrient Ag Solutions of Irvington and Laverne for all your crop input needs.
Snap-on Tools, the most valued tool storage solutions in the world.
Postseason sports club members bringing you this game.
More postseason sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Emeralds, featuring your favorite steaks and seafood.
Sportsman's Corner, Can-Am and Honda side-by-sides, ATVs and motorcycles.
Good Samaritan Society Algona, senior housing and services rooted in God's love.
Carol Implement of Laverne, serving area farming communities for over 50 years.
Schindler Lawn Care and Landscaping, call 515-320-3840.
Farmers Co-op of Addison and Algona, offering Kent Show feeds.
All sponsors of this postseason broadcast.
Get ready for the second half on Hometown Radio KLGA and at the Algona Radio YouTube live stream. The 14-9 St. Ansgar Saints and the 21-2 Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears is right now. The Class 1A number 5 Bears have a 36-18 lead at the half as we get ready to begin half number 2. Well, Beanie, big first couple minutes here for the Bears. They can remove all doubt in the first couple minutes, or St. Ansgar can fix some of the issues they had in the first half and try to slowly get back into it.
Yeah, I think all the pressure's on St. Ansgar. They have to come out with a rally here at the beginning of the third quarter, or it is all she wrote, I think. And I hate to prognosticate that far in advance, but I don't see any way for them to turn this thing around because they haven't really exhibited a shooter or a player that can turn things around for them.
Capacious inbounds towards Bartolo in the backcourt, and we are rolling here in quarter number 3 as Bishop Garrigan currently doubling up St. Ansgar 36-18. Eastman screens, Bartolo heads to the right. Now Eastman gets it near side to Montag. Quick pass to Capacious. Capacious right across the foul line finds Aulish. Aulish catch and shoot on the three, and she swished it!
She was just making them in warm-ups before the first bell sounded, and Boyd carries right into the real time.
The Bears pick up in the second half where they left off in the first half. Also, a season average of 11 points per game. She has six so far tonight as the ball goes out of bounds along the far side. St. Ansgar will keep it as Hicken will be the inbounder in front of the Garrigan student section. Decked out in construction gear tonight. Hicken looking, bouncing it into Anderson. Knocked out by Bartolo, and it will stay of St. Ansgar. In the first half, leading scorer was Anderson for the Saints. She had 8 points. Lindsay Cruzy had six. As Hicken gets the ball into Falk. 30 seconds into the third quarter as Bishop Garrigan leads 39-18. Hicken tries to keep the ball away from Aulish, finds Falk just to the right of center, guarded by Capacious. Falk backs up two steps, flings it to the near side towards Porish. Porish into the paint, it's Cruzy, shoots past Eastman, missed it, ball deflects towards Capacious. It's a fight for the rebound, Capacious dives on it, and she got it out to Bartolo. Another board by Abby Capacious. And then a steal by Anderson, here she comes. Anderson layup, settles into the cup.
Well, Anderson, really opportunistic play there. She was getting swarmed on offense by Emmy Bartolo. Garrigan has decided to face guard Anderson, meaning Emmy Bartolo is going to be nose-to-nose with Anderson the rest of the game unless Schwab goes back to the zone.
Eastman screens as Capacious heads right. Now it's Montag flinging it. Eastman, great catch on the block. Finds Capacious in the corner. Now back inside Eastman. Eastman fades back. Turnaround pops out. No good. Capacious off of the board and gets it to the foul line to Eastman. Eastman steps in for a jumper. Missed it right side. And the rebound controlled by Falk for St. Ansgar. Here come the Saints the other way. They fling it up ahead to Porish. Porish sidestepping Montag, finding the elbow. Pivots 360 and gets it out to the right to Falk. Falk into the right corner to Hicken. 6:30 left in the first half. Into the paint is Cruzy. Bangs away inside, missed the layup. Goddard missed back, put back, no, but a foul.
Now that was good offense by the Ansgar, but they continue to miss those shots. So that's the question, Tyler. They're down 19 points. They don't have time to shoot one for 10 every 10 shots. They got to start putting some buckets in, and I just don't know if they have that person that can shoot that well. We shall find out, folks.
That's the thing. That shot in the second half has to be 75 to 80% for the Saints to really do some damage here as the free throw goes down.
Yeah, and Garrigan, pretty experienced team at this point. They played in a couple close games this year, took a loss earlier in the season. They've gotten pretty good at finishing out contests.
Second free throw on the way, and that one is swished as well. Cruzy with a couple foul shots to make it 39-22. Garrigan in the lead of 6:22 left in quarter number three in this regional semifinal. Could we see a Garrigan versus Riceville rematch on Wednesday night? Still much to be determined in both these games as Bartolo drives in. Bartolo takes a wide angle. No good on the layup. Rebound controlled by Cruzy. Gets it out to Anderson. Anderson runs the floor. Anderson gets it back towards the center, top of the arc. Flings it left side towards Porish. The junior gives back off to the senior Anderson. Now it's Porish getting it between the circles to Falk with 5:58 left in the third. Right side to Hicken, hands the ball off to Anderson, working against Bartolo. Anderson at the foul line. Anderson wants to drive in. Anderson splits two defenders. Shot blocked. Capacious collects it. Capacious trying to weave out of traffic, has to keep the ball away from Anderson, who's always pestering the ball handler. Now it's Bartolo across half court.
Anderson is just trying to will her team back into this game. She is working so hard out there, that young player. Number 13 she wears, she's going for it.
Eastman fades back, turnaround jumper goes down. 41-22, Bishop Garrigan. Eastman up to 19 points.
Garrigan's going to stay in their man-to-man defense. They're straight up man-to-man.
Here's Anderson getting it out. Left wing free, Porish, and that one misses off to the right. Rebound tracked down again by Capacious. She had 9 rebounds against North Iowa on Tuesday night, and Capacious averages just under 11 rebounds per game to go along with 11.5 points. Here's Bartolo finding Eastman at the foul line. Eastman into the right corner to Bartolo. Lets it rip again, and that one, no good. Rebound near side by Falk. Here comes Anderson striding towards the front court. Gets it off to Porish, now inside to Cruzy. Cruzy over Capacious. Missed the layup. Rebound by Eastman. Got it off to Capacious right side. Wings it up ahead towards Montag, now into the corner to Bartolo. 4:47 left and a quick moving third quarter. Capacious holds between the circles, looks for the signal from Coach Schwab, and will hand it off to Bartolo to get the Garrigan offense rolling with 20 on the shot clock. Bartolo dribbles just inside of half court. She backs up. Now she looks left to Capacious. Capacious getting the screen by Montag as she goes right. Aulish now deep on the right wing, 9 on the shot clock. Aulish steps back. All a three-point try. No, she missed it right. Rebound to Eastman, though. Eastman works the baseline. Eastman wants to reverse. Shot rejected by Porish out of bounds.
Oh, what a shot by Ollis. She does the step-back three, just misses. But those long rebounds on three-pointers, sometimes it's hard to predict where they're going. And everybody on the floor was just frozen, looking at that ball in the air. No one's reacting to get to the rebound. But Eastman grabbed it, gets a shot.
Now it's Capacious, got the ball dislodged, but she was fouled. She was bumped on the play by Hicken, who picks that one up. That is the first personal foul on Hicken and the first foul on St. Ansgar this quarter. One foul on each team so far.
Coach Schwab going to take a full timeout here, talk things over with the score being 41-22.
Timeout by Coach Schwab and a timeout for us as well on Hometown Radio KLGA and at the El Gordo Radio YouTube channel.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine postseason sports club members.
Marceau's Golden Harvest Seed Sales, Jim Marceau.
Advanced Interior Care, professional home and business cleaning of carpet, ceramic floors, upholstery, and window treatments.
Algona Dairy Queen, enjoy your favorite DQ treats. They're open for the season.
Algona Hearing Center, better living through better hearing.
Stone and Steel, offering top-of-the-line customer service for your next countertop remodel or new home build.
All sponsors of this postseason game broadcast.
At Security State Bank, we realize each customer has a unique set of needs and goals. That's why we place a greater value on providing outstanding customer service. All products and services are designed for customers within our local community. We value each customer that walks through our door and wants to give them the personalized attention they deserve. Find out why Security State Bank in Algona, Burt, and Laverne is your partner in community banking. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Security State Bank.
.416 left in quarter number three. Tyler Lance alongside Beanie Bodie here on Hometown Radio KLGA as Emmy Bartola has the ball going right for Garrigan. Finds Montag now out to Capacious. Looking for Eastman at the foul line. Hands it right back off to Capacious. The give and go results in 2 points.
Classic give and go. Eastman at the free throw line. The ball goes from Capacious to Eastman. Capacious hard cut to the basket. No one's going to get in front of her. Easy two.
6 points so far tonight for Capacious, who's impacting this game in so many different ways for Garrigan. It's Peterson left side for St. Ansgar. Finds Porce at the foul line. Jumper will hop on the rim and drop through.
There's a good touch on the shoot, on the shooter there. That's what St. Ansgar has been begging for, a shot that just gets the bounce.
Into the left corner to Sasha Allish on the other end for Garrigan. Allish steps back, three on the way, and it deflects on the rim and it drops in. The friendly rubber rim for Sasha Allish. And it's been that kind of night for the Garrigan offense.
Talk about a bounce. I don't know. That defied the laws of physics. Bounce and then up and then off the back and all around and in.
That bounced about as high as the shot clock as well. That took a huge bounce off the rim and still dropped through. Hickon on the right side in front of the St. Ansgar bench. Gets it out to Falk. Rotates left to Peterson. Back to the right wing to Falk. Knocked away by Allish. It'll go into the scoring table out of bounds.
Allish flinched a little bit. She thought about going for the steal, then hesitated, and then went for it again and still almost got it. Had she broken on that immediately, she'd be going the other way for a layup. As it is, 46-24. Bears stretching out their lead in the third quarter.
Cruzy will take a rest on the bench as Jar replaces her in the lineup, wearing jersey number 33. Saints have the basketball right now of Hickon left side. Hickon into the high post to Porish. Now onto the top of the key to Peterson, and Peterson shuffled the shoes.
And Peterson doesn't even, she has an open three there and has a shot on goal there that she just doesn't take without some three-pointers dropping. I don't see St. Ansgar being able to cut into this monumental lead.
Now it's Bartolo getting the ball to Capacious left wing. 2:48 left in the third quarter. Right corner to Montag. Montag looking inside, nothing there. Out to the top of the key to Bartolo. Bartolo drives in, scores on the layup.
Oh, what a great fake by Bartolo. She faked like she was going to kick it out to the three-pointer and carried along to the hoop.
And just exploded to the bucket that time. Jumper from the lane, that is a swish. Porsche knocks it down as she's getting into the ball game with a couple buckets. Back the other way quickly, Garrigan. Here's the reverse by Eastman and the score.
Great technically difficult shot there by Eastman, the reverse layup. Both teams just happy to trade buckets for a while here.
21 points so far by Eastman. St. Ansgar has the basketball. Getting out to the left side. Here's the baseline jumper on the way. That one bounces on the rim and it drops through. That's Aspen Falk knocking it down.
Well, this is the kind of rhythm I think St. Ansgar thought they would start the game with. But again, they spotted Garrigan a huge lead right off the bat.
Bishop Garrigan in the lead with 1:53 left. Ball deflected and stolen by the Saints with 1:50 left here in the third quarter. It's Falk flinging it up ahead. A catch by Hickon on the near side. Hickon into the lane, knocked out by Eastman, and it will stay with St. Ansgar.
Right in front of the cheerleaders over there. Getting a workout today. Got five cheerleaders and, of course, Gary the Bear over there by the entrance. There's been a Greg Oller sighting over there by Father Zach in the administration.
Yeah, what a corner that is over there by the Garrigan student section.
Yeah, it's like an advantage, Garrigan, because they have the student section, plus the cheerleaders, the mascot, and the administration all sprawled out onto the floor there. Little home court advantage.
They're putting all their eggs in that basket down in that corner. Yeah. I'll say this, too. Gary the Bear, he's an honorary cheerleader. I always see him hanging out down there along the baseline right next to the cheerleading squad. I'm surprised he doesn't know the whole routine by now, Beanie.
Yeah, he'll get it.
Jar foul line jumper, and that drops through. St. Ansgar's gotten a couple good deflections this quarter, and it's 52-28.
Well, Garrigan switched back to their 2-3 defense, and St. Ansgar recognized and ran their play. If you can run your plays, you're going to score.
Bartolo has the rock for Garrigan, getting out to Murphy between the circles. Now Hoagland right side, who just checked in. A screen by Murphy as Hoagland flings the left towards Aulish. Aulish crossover dribble. Aulish jump stopping and draws the foul. Number two against St. Ansgar this quarter.
I've seen a lot more confidence out of Aulish today. Not that she hasn't been playing with confidence earlier, but she just seems has raised her game a little bit level. You can see it on her face in that play right there. She handled the ball with some more assertiveness than we've seen.
All right, folks, we got the YouTube stream score fixed. 52-20, or make that 52-30, Garrigan, as the ball gets knocked away. They had the score wrong on the scoreboard here at the gym for a long time, and I didn't want to correct them, but I thought it was wrong, but I wasn't sure. But 52-30 is the score right now. Foul line jumper, rims out by Porsche. Fight for the offensive rebound, and that's going to be a foul on Murphy. Murphy going into Jar that time for foul number two on Garrigan.
This is a good battle for the rebound. Like I said earlier, there's not a ball that comes off that rim. There's not contact on. The officials are really earning that paycheck tonight, and they're doing a nice job so far.
22-point advantage right now by Garrigan, and that is going to be a foul in the center of the paint. This one is going to go against St. Ansgar. Looked like Jar was trying to get loose that time.
Well, Jarvis was trying to set a screen, and she held the Garrigan defender that was trying to break through the screen. The official saw that and says, now no holding. This is not football.
So that's foul number three against Jar as Aulish gives off to Bartol and then gives right back to Aulish. Aulish at the near side of the court gets ready to break it across the timeline. Aulish guarded right now by Porish. Hands the ball towards Hoagland to 52 seconds left in the third quarter. 25 on the shot clock. Bullet pass by Eastman out to Murphy. Right back to Eastman. Eastman turns and passes to Aulish left side. Aulish catches, releases, misses the three. Rebound tracked down on the right baseline by Eastman. Out to Hoagland. Hoagland from downtown. Banks off to the left. Rebound controlled by Porish. St. Ansgar has it. Shot clock and game clock about even. Maybe a half second difference as there's 31 on the game clock. Bullet inside to Jar. Blocked by the foul. That is against Eastman, and that is number three on her.
Yeah, Eastman, the freshman post. We've seen all season, you know, Eastman's, she's got 21 points today. What this team does without Eastman this year is a question we'll never know, because she came in, she joins the team, and now Coach Schwab can carry on with that post offense that he runs so well. Crooks leaves, Eastman in, and the offense continues. But she's going to come out now in foul trouble, so is Bartolo. I like to think, Tyler, if Eastman doesn't show up this year, Garrigan is running a lot of press. They're running five guards, and it's going to be even a faster Garrigan game.
I agree with that completely. We talked about this theoretically last year off the air, what Garrigan would look like, and Eastman was not in that equation just because you don't know what freshmen are coming in. And the first time Garrigan fans got introduced to Eastman was on the volleyball court, and when you saw the way she patrolled that front row, you knew Garrigan would have something good on the basketball court this season as well.
Yeah, what an addition to the team. Here goes Aulish to the hoop.
Aulish down the lane. Aulish takes a wide angle and spun it in. Crazy English by Sasha Aulish. 54-30, Bishop Garrigan. Here's a three-point ball. Peterson, 4 seconds left. No good. Rebound in the lane. Ripped away by Jar. Got it out. Three-point try at the buzzer. Off to the left by Falk. No good. And that is the end of the third quarter. Bishop Garrigan extends the lead as they lead 54-30, heading to the fourth on 92.7 KLGA and the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
Thank you to these postseason sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Semco International, matting by design.
Flipside in Laverne, open 7 days a week, dine in or carry out.
Capacious Brothers Incorporated, Pioneer Seed.
Advanced Drainage Systems, our reason is water.
Lichter's Garage Opener Service and Appliance Repair. The City of Algona, now accepting applications for the Algona Aquatic Center, an equal opportunity employer.
Making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
When you need cash on the go, there's no need to pay a surcharge fee with MoneyPass. Iowa State Bank is proud to be part of the MoneyPass network of surcharge-free ATMs found nationwide. Look for the green and blue MoneyPass symbol on over 32,000 ATMs across the nation. Or find an ATM near your vacation spot or travel destination at MoneyPass.com. MoneyPass, another way that Iowa State Bank helps people succeed. Member FDIC.
start of the fourth quarter on Hometown Radio KLGA. Bishop Garrigan outscoring St. Ansgar 18-12 during the third, and now the Golden Bears lead 54-30 as the Saints will head towards the bucket down to our right. 7:58 and rolling on the clock here as the fourth quarter begins. St. Ansgar has the basketball wearing red jerseys as Peterson, Anderson checks back in. Into the lane to Cruzy, who also checked back in, bangs it off the window and scores.
Well, Cruzy made that shot look easy. All of her other shots have looked very difficult, but boy, she knocks that one down, no problem.
Bishop Garrigan has the basketball right now as Bartolo goes over to Aulish. Aulish heading right around the perimeter, flings it over to Montag. Now back towards Capacious, top of the key. Looks inside, nothing there. Ball knocked away by Falk. Capacious tracks back down and keeps it away from Anderson. Finds Bartolo, sidesteps, three on the way. Off the heel, no good. Rebound tracked down by Porsche. A long rebound for the Saints. Porsche fires up ahead, knocked away by Bartolo, out of bounds into the Saints bench. She was looking for Anderson that time.
Looks like Garrigan's going to settle into their 2-3. I'd say that's the defense they're probably most comfortable with. It's the defense that's hard to crack. It makes the team run a lot of time off the clock. And with a lead like this, that's all they need to do, keep that clock running.
And Capacious playing at the center of that 2-3 zone as the ball knocked away. Eastman trying to track it down, and there's a scrum on the floor for it right now, and that is going to be a jump ball. Eastman landing on top of Hicken as they both went for that. Possession arrows towards Bishop Garrigan as the Golden Bears get it back. The Saints, in their first round game, beat a very familiar opponent, Newman Catholic, 59-40. But in that game, they held Newman Catholic to 31% shooting and 2 of 18 on threes. This Garrigan team, substantially hotter than that three-point shooting-wise. We've talked about it all night as the three balls are back. Aulich on the left side with 1 minute gone here in quarter number four. She'll head right around the arc, gives off to Montag right wing. Montag looks, fires inside to Eastman. It's through her hands, though, and it's out of bounds, though. Last touch by Cruzy, who had to go through her hands as well. Pass came with some smoke as Bartolo inbound from the right side baseline. Garrigan lines up four cross right now as Bartolo looks. Bartolo flings it in off the hands of Eastman and picked up by Porish, and Porish got sandwiched and she got fouled.
Well, Tyler, roughly 7 minutes left to go in this game for Garrigan's to march on to the next round of this tournament. We always like to say that anything can happen in a tournament, and that first round was tough, but now things are kind of falling into place. And we talked about that, too. That happens a lot in tournaments where the first round is upsets. It doesn't matter if it's NCAA men or whatever. The first round, that's a chance where teams can pull some upsets. But then once these favored teams like Garrigan is in this bracket, once that starts happening, you know, things start to fall into place, and that's falling into place right now. They're looking. They got a scoreboard problem is what's going on, folks.
On the scoreboard, it says 154-32. Sorry, folks. Garrigan's got a good offense, but they don't have 154 points right now. It's just 54.
Yeah, so they're going to reset things, and I think they got to figure out what we got to reset the shot clock, make sure the score's
right. They've got to take it down 1 point at a time from 154. That's agonizing for the scoreboard operators.
Tyler, this is a great opportunity for me to tell the Algona community why they haven't seen you out running the streets of Algona lately. I heard the injury report on the national running report, and you are dealing with some injuries here. But you'll be out on the roads of Algona soon, right? You're just waiting for the warm weather, and then we'll see you out sprinting down State Street again, running on the local tracks.
I don't know anything about waiting for warmer weather. I'm out in the warm, the cold, it doesn't matter to me.
And that's why we love it. That's why we see you there. We see you sprinting around town here. Now the coaches are going to come together. It looks like we got it all figured out. It's interesting. You're not allowed to meet with your team here. It's not a timeout. So all the girls are standing on the floor just hanging around waiting to go.
Stop everything. We've got Coach Schwab at the controls right now, Beanie. Get that camera on Coach Schwab. He's figuring it out right now. He's pressing the dials. He's turning the buttons. You know, this is his hardest task of the night, Beanie.
I know in the back closet we have the old flip chart. We can get the flipper out like we use in the little kid tournaments, and we can just flip the points over that way. And now the officials are going to say, you know what? Everybody is now allowed to go to their benches. You don't have to stand there on the floor and wait for this. We will get this figured out, folks. And, yeah, Coach Schwab, as likely as anyone to know how to do that, because coaches often use the scoreboard during practice and to run drills and stuff. Coach Meister going to come over. Coach Rob Meister, he's the athletic director here at Garrigan. He's going to come over, and we might have to call the scoreboard salesperson. I think it's a Daktronics. It's a Daktronics. We're going to have to get Daktronics in here to straighten this out.
Oh, man, that sounds like a lot of waiting on the phone and waiting through holding and call music in the background. Well, they got it down to the right score right now, but it kept flashing back up to 154 points.
I'll say this, Tyler. Thank goodness it's not 54-54 with a tense game on the line. You hate to see a clock issue become something there, but Bears with this healthy lead, I don't think they're too worried.
They're making an announcement about it on the PA announcement right now. Oh, 52-32. So they gave Garrigan two extra points somewhere along the line. I mentioned that earlier tonight. They've been a little shaky on the scoreboard tonight. The score's been wrong multiple times, and it had me fooled as well. It is 52-32. They can't change it, though, so it's going to say 54-32 on the scoreboard. So we've got it right on our YouTube stream right now, 52-32, but on the scoreboard at the gym, they've got it wrong. They've given Garrigan two extra points, so that is what they're trying to figure out.
Well, if they want it to be a 20-point game, they could also just move to the side and let Moses part the Red Sea and let St. Ansgar go in for an easy layup and then give him the ball right back. And that would be a sportsmanlike thing to do here, which, of course, with a kind of a big lead here in the fourth quarter. They put some time back on the clock as well. Now it was down to about 6:50 in the game. Now it says 7:08.
All right, well, that, I don't know why they did that, because there was clearly more than a minute that ran off the clock. The clock was fine before. I have no idea why they had to go back to 7:08.
Well, I guess they're just trying to make sure everyone's getting their money's worth. And Gary the Bear is doing some leg lifts over there.
Oh, man, Gary the Bear working on that six-pack.
Yeah, he is getting a workout in front of the student section, but they quit cheering for him, so he says, that's enough. I'll go back to my normal position there. And we are going to resume the game of basketball.
All right, well, they never figure out the scoreboard. Now the clock's not even right. There we go. Now the clock's running. All right. There we go, folks. So scoreboard play-by-play tonight. Bet you didn't think you'd see that.
Tyler, have you ever heard about technology causing problems? I mean, ever since the advent of computers, the world's been so much better.
And now we've got a whistle and a stoppage again. I'll tell you what, folks. This is the final home game of the season, but you'd think it'd be the first home game of the season. We had everything right all season long, no issues whatsoever. Now here we go in the last game, unable to get through the fourth quarter.
Well, now since we're having problems, I hope these officials are getting a little extra bonus pay as they're having to deal with this going on. The head officials now coming to the bench to say, this is the situation and this is what we're going to do. And we got a good crew down there. Boy, they've been – and, they're of course, they're all volunteers. All these things happen with so many volunteers working. And the crowd understands that. I will say, the crowds tonight have been fantastic, very well-mannered. We read before every game a nice sportsmanship thing. Tonight's crowd, they actually listened and responded.
So here we go. They're going to let it play for now. The clock is rolling. It's 52-32, Garrigan, even though the hometown scoreboard has it wrong at the gym. Our YouTube stream is right, though. Porsche, right side three, no good. Deflects and picked up by Capacious. Give these officials overtime pay right now. Give them double time. It's Allish deep on the right wing. 6:48 left in the first half. As you're listening to high school basketball here on Hometown Radio, KLGA Algona. Montag on the left side gets it out towards Capacious. Capacious looking, and takes one dribble and hands it off to Bartolo. 52-32, Garrigan. Bartolo lost the ball, picked it back up. Bartolo trying to pivot around, and she draws the foul. First on St. Ansgar of this quarter.
Boy, yeah, this is 6.5 minutes left to go in this game. 20-point lead, I think. And,
yes.
Boy, there's just no quit on the faces of any of these girls. The Garrigan girls are still pushing the tempo. And St. Ansgar, of course, desperately trying to get back in this game.
Bartolo, left side corner, lets it rip, swishes again. Automatic tonight, 55-32.
Boy, Bartolo, stone cold tonight.
Bartolo's approaching her career high. She had 19 on December 7th in that loss against Newell Fonda. She has 15 right now. Eastman of 21, as Capacious has 6. And 11 by Stacia Allish tonight. Saints working around the perimeter to Falk. Falk stopped along the baseline, her pass back beyond the perimeter, deflected, and Falk got it back herself. Falk back and forth with her and Hicken. It's a deep three by Hicken. It's an air ball along the baseline, batted back in by Cruzy, but she was out of bounds as she did that.
St. Ansgar gets a three-point look there, but nowhere close. Anderson trying everything she can to steal that ball.
Bartolo up ahead to Montag. Montag lets it rip. Free ball short and collected on the rebound by Cruzy. Hey, the scoreboard got it figured out. When Garrigan hit that last three, they gave Garrigan one. So the score is now correct on the game scoreboard and the YouTube scoreboard. 55-32. That's the Garrigan score. Interior pass knocked away by Eastman and taken by Capacious.
St. Ansgar just trying to force it into Cruzy.
Allish pulls up for a three. Airballs it as it goes out of bounds along the left baseline. Not many of those tonight for Garrigan. Beanie, you talked about that North Iowa game that, you know, some of the concern for Garrigan was that they weren't just missing free, they were missing them badly. Tonight, even the ones they missed have been good looks. That was kind of the first one that was an air ball tonight for the Golden Bears.
Yeah, rushed a little bit there in the St. Ansgar student section. Let her have it there. as they should. Good sportsmanship. The St. Ansgar clearly brought a pep bus because their student section is mostly junior high kids that I feel probably can't drive. I don't see a lot of the high school crowd here. Oh, no, they're just obscured by the youngsters. Good crowd there, though, St. Ansgar.
Yeah, high school crowd gets the front couple rows. Junior high after that. Bends the rules, as they say. Inbound to the Falk with 5:19 left. St. Ansgar has the basketball. The bucket is towards our right. Falk at the foul line. Finds the curling Porsche, top of the key, deep tray, and it pops into the cup. It rattles and drops through.
Well, she's been their best shooter so far, so Falk has got to shoot more for them to get back in this. They're down 20, 5 minutes left.
55-35. Porsche now 5 points so far tonight. She's just under a 37% three-point shooter on the year. As a 20-point advantage right now by Garrigan. Capacious pumps and finds Eastman just to the right of center. Now it's Bartolo coming back towards the near side. Off to Capacious, looks left. St. Ansgar covers up the Montag backdoor cut. Now Aulish driving right side, flings it into Eastman. Center of the paint, takes a hard dribble, puts it off glass and scores.
Good offense by Garrigan. Eastman ends up with a bucket, but all those four guards work that ball around and create that for her. Eastman with 23. And thank the guard for a lot of those.
Here's Porsche from the other free, just a bit too strong. Wide rebound deflects out to Aulish left side, and Aulish is fouled. Fouled by Porsche on that one. The second foul by St. Ansgar. Eastman's also approaching their career high. Her career high was 26, set back on January 16th against Lake Mills. As you mentioned, Beanie, she has 23 so far tonight.
Yeah, just a very good, mature team by Bishop Garrigan. Even though they're young, they make a lot of good, mature decisions on the floor.
Into the right corner to Aulish, all by herself. Three-point try is pure. 60-35, Bishop Garrigan. That's 14 tonight from Stacia Aulish, who has the shooting touch back as well. Pass near half court, almost thrown into the backcourt, but Hicken makes a nice grab for St. Ansgar. 4 minutes left in the fourth. Anderson just inside the three-point line. Lets the dribble rip and buries it from about 18 feet, and that'll make it 60-37.
She's got a good, nice, open look there and drains it. She's got to be their best score. Her and Falk are trying their best to shoot them back into this, but Garrigan's knocking down threes, and they're knocking down twos.
A foul by Anderson for St. Ansgar, picking it up. That is her fourth personal, coming with 3:49 left in the fourth. A 60-37 advantage by Bishop Garrigan. Trying to follow a similar path that they took last year to the regional final. They beat St. Ansgar in the second round, then faced Riceville in the third round. At some point tonight, probably in the postgame, we'll try to get a score on that Riceville versus Gladbrook-Rhinebeck game and see what's coming up next. Bartolo step back three, rims out, rebound chased down by Eastman on the right block. Eastman looks for Montag near side. No look past the Bartolo top of the key with 3.5 minutes left in the fourth quarter.
Well, even that missed three-point shot by Bartolo, she shot that with utmost confidence. The confidence in these shots that we just have not seen the last few games. So good to see that confidence come back.
16 on the shot clock. Capacious flings it into Eastman. Eastman got by and scored.
Grayson Eastman has clearly just really put the time into the gym and rehearsed that shot so much. I know she's heading down to Des Moines for a beef expo tomorrow. Her sister's already down there, I guess. She's a student here at Bishop Garrigan as well. And they're showing some cattle tomorrow.
Eastman has 25 points. The first team all-conference selection is there's a free ball. No good by Hicken off the front of the iron. Ball's along the baseline and out of bounds as ball is going to be kept here by St. Ansgar. Hicken will inbound from the right side baseline as Murphy checks in for the Golden Bears. Three subs coming in for St. Ansgar. The sophomore McKenna Norby checking into the ball game.
Boy, Cruzy comes out, gets a break, a good round of applause by her crowd there. She's got bruises on her arms. I'm sure she's just had such a season there at St. Ansgar. Congrats to her, but it looks like it's going to end tonight.
Saints have also brought in Natalie Bork, a senior, as the shot misses. Capacious rebounds before the Golden Bears. As Bishop Garrigan has the basketball, bringing it across to half court with 2:38 left. It's Bartolo guarded by Norby right now. As Saints have also brought Bork into the ballgame, as you mentioned, working against Eastman. Eastman turn around and she puts it in! 27 points by Eastman and a new career best. 64-37 Garrigan, 2:20 left. Jars back in for St. Ansgar as well. There's a three-point try. Porsche misses left. Ball deflects out of bounds. Last touch by Bishop Garrigan.
Here comes Hogan into the game. 2 minutes left. We'll see when Coach Schwab decides to sub. 64-37 is the lead. He brings Aulish out. You know, now you start to get a little antsy for that next game. You want to make sure no one rolls an ankle or anything, so I expect the benches to clear soon. St. Ansgar coach has subbed three players in so far.
2:11 left, 64-37. Bishop Garrigan as Falk tries a free, and she banks it in. Aspen Falk knocks down a free, and it's 64-40. Nice moment there for the senior.
Coach Schwab turns around and chats it up with the student section from St. Ansgar right behind him. They have a laugh.
That's 9 points by Falk so far tonight. Here's Bartolo trying to shake loose.
Yeah.
And Coach Schwab's going to take a timeout.
Yeah, I think this timeout, try to get some subs in, set up an offense here, and make sure everyone knows what the plan here is for the final 2 minutes of the game. Or he might be thinking, well, Eastman just set her career high. Let's see if we can get her to 30 points. We saw him do that with, it was nice when Crooks would get a high or Joyce would get a career high, Capacious gets a career high. He says, well, let's see how high we can take your career.
Well, 27 points right now for Eastman. I'd say probably don't worry about that tonight if you're Garrigan. Eastman's got a whole 4 years to chase that 30-point mark, and I'm sure she'll be hitting that at some point.
She's staying in there. They break the huddle, and you've still got the main lineup in there. You got Eastman, Hoagland, Bartolo, Capacious, and Murphy the senior are the Garrigan five. St. Ansgar, good luck, Tyler. All new numbers.
All right, well, we'll get to that in a second, but big thank you to Bernie Merrill, our station manager, who just sent me an update on the Riceville game. It looks like it's going to be Garrigan against Riceville. Riceville's leading Gladbrook-Rhinebeck 43-30 with 3 minutes left in that game, so Riceville's in control there. Garrigan's in control here, and we could see a Garrigan versus Riceville part three. Eastman at 5 seconds. Eastman long two for foot on the line. That one's too strong. Rebounded by Jar for St. Ansgar.
Oh, she was hoping to hit a three-pointer and get to 30. Yeah, you guys, I know it. That would have been fun.
64-40, Bishop Garrigan. Jar flings it towards the paint. There's a right elbow jumper on the way. That one's off the back of the iron by Sophie Urbach, who had just checked into the ball game. Rebound collected by Murphy. Bringing it across half court, it's going to be Abby Capacious for Bishop Garrigan. Josie Jewell into the ball game as well.
Josie Jewell
for St. Ansgar. There's a drive by Bartolo. She got tripped up and fouled with 1:04 left.
All right, now the subs are coming here. That scares you there. Bartolo hit the ground pretty hard. Don't need any wear and tear on that fantastic game tonight. Boy, was she outstanding as the subs are going to come in.
And you've got to savor this moment if you're the Garrigan substitutes. And the hometown crowd is going to give Garrigan a standing ovation. So the starters need to savor this moment as well, your final home game. But you never know when it's going to be the last time for your bench player coming in, especially as the games get tougher down the stretch of the playoffs.
Got Haley Nemers, Reese Kemna, Carly Nielsen. And the senior Casey is in the game. Elena Casey under the hoop.
1:02 left in this ball game. As Bishop Garrigan has the ball, they almost throw it away, and they do throw it away. Norby intercepts the pass. Here's Norby at 55 seconds, takes it inside, sidearms the pass as she was able to find Jewel, who brings it back out. Jewel gets it around towards Jar. St. Ansgar rotates it around towards Norby on the right wing with 46 seconds left. Garrigan up by 24, down into the right corner, now into the post, to the foul line. It is a jumper by Jar, missed it right, and Nielsen brings in the rebound for Garrigan. 37 seconds left. Nielsen gets bumped. Ball rolls away, and it's picked up by St. Ansgar's Jewel. And then a tie-up there right inside of half court. 33 seconds left. And St. Ansgar will head to the bench again. Bree Tapper checking into the ball game.
Going to try to get everybody in the game there. I think he just
Ava Falk
did
checking
that.
In as well for St. Ansgar.
Try to give a nod to these girls and thank them for their season here that's going to end. Make sure everyone gets a taste of the hardwood on their last game. It might just be 30 seconds, but that just sends a message from the coach that you really appreciate their work.
And Alexis Frein, the final substitute for St. Ansgar, checks in as well, so they've gotten everyone in tonight. Some action in their final game of the season, as here's a left elbow jumper on the way. That banks off the glass, no good, as Falk can't knock it down. Rebound tracked down by St. Ansgar. Urbach brings it back out. Urbach free, no. Offensive board, put back, no, but a foul. And Tappert's going to be heading to the line for two shots with 14 seconds left.
All right, Tyler, here's my question. When Garrigan gets the ball, will they run the floor and try to score, or are they just going to dribble it out?
You know what? I say try to score. Just give Elena Casey a bucket in her last game.
Yeah,
you know,
let's give Elena Casey a bucket.
If anyone else besides a senior was on the floor, I'd say no. But because Elena Casey's out there, I'd say try to get her a point here at the end.
You bet. She's a senior. She's playing her last game in this gym. She has had 4 years of practice. She's banged down low with Audie Crooks. Now she's playing all year. Yeah, let's hope she gets a bucket in these last 14 seconds.
And Garrigan will get one more possession as the second free throw goes down and makes it 64-41. So 64-41, Garrigan.
Ava Rother in the game for the Bears.
Near half court, it's Kemna. Garrigan's got to dribble at the clock here. 5 seconds left. Kemna gets it over to the right to Nielsen. Final 3 seconds, 2 seconds, 1 second, and that's it. Bishop Garrigan is on to the regional final. They win their final home game of the season, 64-41. The three-point marksmanship tonight was a driver for Bishop Garrigan and a career high of 27 points by Graceland Eastman as Bishop Garrigan wins tonight, and they are on to the regional final, almost certainly against Riceville, who had a big lead late in the other regional semifinal game. We'll step aside right now for a timeout. Look at the final numbers coming up next on 92.7 KLGA and the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
In farming, there are many risks and hazards that cannot be controlled. However, you can control how you protect your crops with insurance. Hi, this is Jason Bradley, agent with PMC Advantage Insurance Services in Algona. We help insure your crops against the elements and the unknown. At PMC Advantage, several agents can obtain the insurance you need to cover your crops properly. Coverage is offered through Farmers Mutual Hail, NAU Country, and ProAg, which allow us to provide multi-peril, hail, wind, green snap, and many more coverages. For your crop insurance needs, contact Jason Bradley, Jim Black, or Alex Bluer, or call 515-295-9433, or stop by the Algona or West Bend offices. PMC Advantage Insurance Services, a Pharmacist Mutual Insurance Company.
We've got more postseason sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Grassmasters, growing satisfied customers.
Trend Salon, your complete family hair salon. It's all about you.
Lusher Family Dentistry, serving your family since 1965 on Call Street in Algona.
Iowa Lakes Community College, your community, your college.
Erpelding Excavating, they dig dirt.
Bill's Auto and Truck Repair, getting you back on the road.
All sponsors of this postseason broadcast.
Thank you to these postseason sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Semco International, matting by design.
Flipside in Laverne, open 7 days a week, dine in or carry out.
Capacious Brothers Incorporated, Pioneer Seed.
Advanced Drainage Systems, our reason is water.
Lichter's Garage Opener Service and Appliance Repair. The City of Algona, now accepting applications for the Algona Aquatic Center, an equal opportunity employer.
Making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Bishop Garrigan is on to the Class 1A6 regional final as tonight they defeat St. Ansgar by a final count of 64-41. And it is official, Beanie. We'll get a Bishop Garrigan versus Riceville. Part three as Riceville wins tonight 46-33 over Gladbrook Rhinebeck. So two of the top 10 teams in the state will battle on Wednesday night for a trip to Wells Fargo Arena. But before we get to that, we're going to look at the final scoring numbers. Unofficial here very quickly. The scoring by quarter went like this. Garrigan jumped out to a 10-0 lead right off the bat in the first quarter and led 22-9 at the end of one. The Golden Bears would outscore the Saints 14-9 in the second, going up 36-18 at the half. Bishop Garrigan had an 18-12 scoring advantage in the third quarter as they led 54-30 going to the fourth, and then St. Ansgar outscored the Golden Bears 11-10 in that final period. Some unofficial scoring leaders for the Golden Bears: Graceland Eastman had 27 points, Emmy Bartolo with 15, Stacia Allish with 14, and Abby Capacious with 8. Kinsey Anderson led the way of 12 for St. Ansgar as Lindsay Cruzley had 10 and Aspen Falk had 9. They were the leading scorers on the Saints in tonight's ball game. Obini, we'll start from the very beginning because this was a tone-setting performance for Bishop Garrigan. Scoring those first 10 points, knocking down those deep triples in the first quarter, really set the tone for this game. St. Ansgar kind of got just thunderstruck at the start of this ball game and really never could recover from that start that Garrigan had.
Oh, the first 30 seconds just kind of said the whole theme of the game. Garrigan was going to be more aggressive. They were going to be faster. They were going to be just quicker on their offense, and they were going to be fearless and with much more confidence than we've seen. I don't know what's been going on with that team. Their shots haven't been there. They've been in a slump, just like you see in lots of sports. And they've been in a slump with their three-point shooting, but whatever they did in the preparation for this game, boy, it worked. They got to keep doing that because they came out of the gates just on fire. And on the flip side, St. Ansgar just couldn't make anything. And it seems so simple when you point it out like that. But if a team doesn't make their shots and you make all yours, bada bing, bada boom, you're going to win the game. And boy, Garrigan just marching on. You know, they're the number fifth ranked team in the state. The state does a nice job of drawing up the brackets. Garrigan gets the one seed, and they've been marching through this bracket and going to face Riceville again, and they've just got to be – St. Ansgar as well. These teams have just got to be getting sick of having to play Garrigan every year in this tournament.
Yeah, that's the thing. teams from this point into the East, you've got to go through Garrigan at some point, and that's been the case over the past several years as Garrigan has gone to the state title game 4 years in a row, and they've won back-to-back titles. But tonight, they beat St. Ansgar 64-41, second straight year beating the Saints in the regional semifinals. And, you know, we'll say this for Garrigan as well tonight. Like we said, three-point shooting back on track as well, but they got to face a man-to-man defensive team tonight, a team that pressed a little bit as well. So two things, Garrigan doesn't see a whole lot. And Coach Schwab kind of went to the clipboard, drew up a few plays that maybe the Saints hadn't seen on film from Garrigan a lot this season. And, boy, Garrigan just really picked apart that defense. The ball movement was great. The move without the ball was great as well. And just all factors coming together on offense.
Yeah, they were prepared, and it's just so much easier when you can check all the boxes and what you want in a team. You know, in 1A girls basketball, it really just seems to be a case of the haves and the have-nots. And not that everyone doesn't have players that work hard, but you got to have certain things. You got to have the ball handlers. Garrigan checks that box. You got to have an inside post presence. Garrigan checks that box. You got to have girls that are aggressive. Garrigan checks that box. They just have all those things that you need to build a big, a good team. And Coach Schwab will be the first to tell you and credit those girls. You know, Sasha Alish, Emmy Bartolo, Zoe Montag, Abby Capacious, Grayson Eastman, all the whole team, Alyssa Hogan off the bench, like they all practice so much. They all play in these summer leagues. They shoot a million shots a year. And so they get to this point and they expect their shots to go in because they've just put so much time into this sport. And so they have, and other teams have not in these cases, in these big games.
And St. Ansgar is going to look back on this game and see some missed opportunities. They got the ball inside a lot tonight. They got a lot of offensive rebounds, but just the putbacks weren't there. A lot of point-blank misses tonight. Just some of the things that get tough on the road in a tough, hyped environment like this was the pressure of a second-round postseason game. And sometimes you felt that pressure just rushing the Saints a little bit as they missed a few opportunities tonight.
Yeah, they did. And all those opportunities were really in the first half. And it was just too late. Their second half was pretty solid. They got the shots to start falling, but in that first half, they looked completely, I think the word you used was thunderstruck. I would say shell-shocked. We can pull out all the vocabulary for the sports analogies, but they really, really looked out of sync. And when you see a team that got this far in the tournament and they're not looking good, you know they're just not on their game, they're not in rhythm, and St. Ansgar was definitely not. We don't have to see all their whole season to be able to see that they weren't playing their best. Then we saw flashes of them in the second half where they started to knock down some buckets with some good looks, and they started to play more aggressive, and suddenly they look like a team that is playing for a chance to play Riceville, but it's just way too late. Too late for them to come back. Garrigan put it away in the first quarter.
Well, folks, it's going to be Bishop Garrigan against Riceville, part three. And if you can't be at that game, be here with us on the Algona Radio YouTube stream, because that's going to be a great game. The number 5-ranked Golden Bears against the number 10-ranked Wildcats for the third year in a row. So will Garrigan go back to Wells Fargo Arena, or will Riceville finally have their revenge? That's going to be the question on Wednesday night, as that's going to be a fantastic ball game for us here on the Algona Radio YouTube channel. That'll wrap it up for tonight, though, from the final home broadcast of the Bishop Garrigan High School season, as the Golden Bears are now 22-2 on the season, and St. Ansgar is going to end their season for a record of 14-10. Wrapping it up for tonight's broadcast, for my partner Beanie Bodie, I'm Tyler Lance signing off. This has been a sports production of Hometown Radio KLGA. As your final score tonight, Bishop Garrigan 64 and St. Ansgar 41.